Hello, everyone. Hi. You had a good keynote in the morning?
Yeah.
Fantastic, great. Awesome, so I think we have a full house now, almost full house. That's great. So let me quickly introduce ourselves. And who are these two guys? So, Ashwini?
Yeah. Morning, all. I'm Ashwini Kumar. I'm working with Srijan Technology as a technical architect. More specific to Drupal, I'm with Drupal with last 6 years. And in contribution, I'm mostly into organizing Drupal camps, Drupal meetups, hackathon, and mentoring new beginners back in India. Recent contribution of mine is in Drupal console, which is actually got released for Drupal 8. And we actually translated Drupal console in Hindi language as well. And it's around 97 point some percentage. And it was completed before last DrupalCon back in Mumbai. So yeah.
Fantastic, thanks. So I'm Gaurav. I'm one of the business heads at Srijan. And I take care of business for US region and some of the parts in Asia. That's a quick introduction. And before we jump on right to the next slide, I just want to know how many people are here from the agencies, who are running agencies or the part of the agencies. Okay, that's less than I expected. And what about else? Are these people from the companies, clients, you know, working in Drupal? Yeah? Okay, fantastic. Great, so, you know, let me just quickly put expectation and say that what essentially we are going to talk about, right? We are not probably going to talk about cases when we have a lot of time, a lot of clarity in terms of what we are going to make, what we are going to build, because we are not assuming that you have done a lot of requirement gathering, a lot of brought a lot of clarity designs with you, you know, while doing the estimates. It's not the place where you have the budgets defined as well, right? And it's very early in the stages. So we are looking at, you know, how do you go on accurate with early estimations? I think before I was building this presentation for the DrupalCon, I looked at several earlier DrupalCon presentations, and you know, almost all of them talked about estimation techniques which relied heavily on, you know, techniques which require a lot of requirements to be in the place. And I mean, and as everyone knows, that's not the ideal situation everywhere, every time, right? So what do we do when we don't have requirements very clear? And how do we go accurate, right? So, and you know, this also includes that how do you sell the whole story? How do you convince clients, or how do you put the message forward that estimations is not something that you can, you know, just make out in a day or a two. It's a long exercise, it requires a lot of hard work into it, and how do you convince clients onto that? So that's the story. Is that okay with everyone? Any questions, concerns? No, fantastic. Okay, what are the problems that we are going to address, right? So anywhere in, you know, almost every agencies I talk to globally, I think this is one of the most least invested activity globally, right? So, you know, you get a RFP, you get a client coming in, barging in and say that, okay, I have a very big project for you, or, you know, which is looking at a marketplace, I'm looking at a community portal, I'm looking at a marketing portal, and, you know, you are experts. What is going to cost, right? You know, you hear a lot like that. So what do, right? You can't really go on and do user stories, you can't really go on build designs, mock-ups, wireframes, to give a huge time investment in building the backlog and then doing the estimations, right? So what do you do? What do you do at that point? Internally, we haven't been very successful with hours-based estimations, you know, and doing that very early in the sales cycle, hours-based estimations actually hampers big time when you go into the development, when you go into the delivery, and we have moved away from that. We have moved away. And I'm going to talk about what we have been doing now in terms of the estimations, early estimations, which is not our space. You know, again, features, I think very, a lot of companies, a lot of agencies globally give all the estimates on the basis of different features. and say that what features is going to, you know, get implemented in what hours, and that's how they essentially budget and, you know, sell all the Drupal projects. That doesn't work as well, right? And, you know, and we have been trying to move all the conversations, and we've been successful as well, from features to complexities, right? And we're going to talk about that as well. And lastly, selling the focus factor, right? Telling the clients that there can be bad days for a developer, there can be days when he's not well, there can be, you know, he's just not in the right mood, you know, and all that things come up. And, you know, you have to understand there can be a limited focus factor for a developer to work on a daily basis, right? And how do you convince that?
And, you know, I'll actually, rather than going into the theory, I'll talk about a case that we worked on, right?
So the brief that we started off with was, I want a marketplace with 250,000 merchants and 1 million SKUs to start with. You are the experts, tell us the time and cost.
That was the only statement.
And we just have 4 months to launch the beta, right?
That was the only statement.
Yeah, so I'm sure it would be pretty common to a lot of agencies, right? And you get across to things like that a lot. What do you do? And it's one of the very big clients in India. We come from India, and we don't want it to lose it for sure, right? And we wanted to make sure that we get inroads and, you know, make mark with pitch.
So we build a base.
We set up a base, and we said that, okay, you don't have a requirements, you don't have a defined understanding of what you want to build. Let me set up a commercial demo and give you a demo, right? And showcase you what exactly, you know, are the features that is out there that is already built in and, you know, available, right? Many times we always try and use this base in some or the other way in all the projects, on all the pitches that we do. Either it's a demo that we're going to do for the distribution, either it's a demo of some other client that we're going to do, either it's a reference website of their current website, but we always try and make sure that we have a base to start with on the conversation, right? And This is all done by the sales guys. There's no delivery or the pre-sales guys coming in. And what works with us that, you know, while we go on and build this base, we talk about the nodes, and we say that, you know, if we talk about our external experience, this is the kind of a budget that, you know, is from our experience should look like. So it sets a base from a purchasing point of view, from a budget point of view, to start off with, right? For the importance thing to in this whole exercise is to make sure that your people involved in this whole estimation exercise understand the organization knowledge very well. They should know what kind of projects you are doing internally, what has been the time that you have spent on that, right? What are different things that you have done, right? Not in a very detailed manner, but on a very holistic level, you know, make sure that understanding is with the sales and the pre-sales team very well. And make sure that, you know, they understand what is a learning curve, what is not a learning curve, right? You know, it's easy for devs to come in, architects to come in and say that what is easy, what is your learning curve, are you looking at React? You know, React is a new language, it's going to take time, and all that stuff. But selling that information, you know, is a training that we spend a lot of time, you know, from a sales angle, which should be there. And, you know, while we set up this base really helps us, you know, in starting the conversation with clients in making sure that they actually get involved in architecting the whole project, right? If you don't have a requirements, you don't have things in place, this base allows to have this conversation starting up. And they get in to, you know, talk about the, you know, what we can do with their whole thing or what essentially they are looking at from an output point of view.
You know, we bring in our different product owners. We have a system where we have both product owners and Scrum Masters as internally at Cision, and we have a product owners at the client end as well.
And these product owners are usually, you know, people who deliver, who are responsible for the final delivery, right? And they come in, we make sure that they prove, you know, and these are usually 4 or 5 hours, you know, they spend on one particular, you know, prospect which has been away from the sales cycle and is a qualified prospect for you. Right, you come in and you say, talk about different questions, you probe in and you find out what are the different things that the person is looking at from the experience level, right? Two?
Yeah, sure. Just quickly, on the theoretical client that you had and the base that you created, this is all in pre-sales or do you assign any type of event over here at this point?
No, it's actually going to be live. It's not a theoretical base, it's a Yeah. And you know, one of the things that we have from our own experience understood that making a note that the teams who are getting into those calls get into migration and integrations on a very deep level. These have been the two biggest unknowns which impact our estimation from a delivery point of view when we deliver, right? Rest of the things get in place easily, but making sure that migration teams and integrations are totally covered. And you know, one very important part is to go on and force them to be engaged, right? So when you have put in a base, you have talked about you know what you can do, and you are going and probing different questions. It's very, very important to tell them very clearly that you have to be engaged with us. You know, I've seen cases where it's very, and these are very exhaustive exercise for clients, right? And if you're coming in and they're looking at 10 different vendors and everyone is giving them a code, you know, they get very irritated sometimes, you know, and say that, you know, why are you asking so many questions, right? Why are you going into so deep? You know, everyone is giving me a code, right? And we have walked away many times from that. Right? So the client is not engaged, right? Then that's probably not the right client for us, right? So we tell them that either you get engaged or we're going to walk away, right? So that has worked because many of them came back to us after year and two because of this whole piece where we have walked away because they were not engaged. And it helps. So here we start with. This is a sheet. To be honest, I don't even remember who made that. But you know, this is very common. I know for sure, right? And used by many people. The original sheet had hours with the confidence factor coming in, but we have changed that, and we have got the rest of the stuff there, with the assumptions, the specifications. But we have removed the hours part and put the story points in place, right? And you know, this is the same exercise. The only difference is that right. Apart from going, asking the poor people who are doing the estimations and ask them to do an hours-based estimation, we ask them to go and do complexity-based story points, right? And we'll talk a little more detail on that and how do we do that. Yeah. You want to talk about? Yeah.
So I made that sheet. So this is the place where I come into the picture. When my client gives hard time to my sales team, and I help them with giving early estimation, basically. Because I was working with agile fashion from last many of years, and usually we have certain research exercise before we took project. So we have a 1 month of the exercise where we actually talk to client, make all the user stories, and put it all the story points, and write down the specifics of certain functionality, and maybe using any kind of tool, Jira or something else. So that's where we have time to actually estimate specific feature, what has to be built. But in the early estimate, we really do not have clarity, as Gaurav also mentioned. For specific functionality, we really do not have to. We have to guess, and we have to guess actually close to that it's going to be built in that particular fashion. So when the epic level, so in an agile fashion, we used to call the epic when sales guys gives us all the jargons like carousel and solar search, and we have to build our e-commerce site, and nobody has any idea what actually needs to be built or what exactly client wants. So we have categorized these functionality or epics into two ways. So we're going to put our assumption and solution of particular feature, and we also give certain reference specification. For example, in Drupal project, while making a Drupal project, we have lot of modules. So let's say there is a solar search functionality in a project, but what is to be there in solar, right? Does solar search should, or on what level the solar search should go? There should be a lot of condition when you actually build those part, right? The facet search and all those things. So we actually break them. And we break them with the assumption, okay, solar will be running, the solar result page will be there, and there are certain facets will be there, and based on certain queries, we're gonna drill down all the results which user want. And other part is the specification, how we can usually identify what specification. It basically comes from the experience when you are making a lot of Drupal sites, so you always know that, okay, there is a module available in Drupal community. So you're gonna just use that, configure it, and things are ready. So that actually help us in identifying and reducing the time, how much time particular feature gonna take for a team to develop or deliver. So before the estimation, first let's understand what is mean by story points and why we do not actually measure things in ours. So if you understand correctly, ours is basically a very hard time, which we say. So in a development team, if someone asks, a manager asks, or any scrum master asks, that how much time it will take, and if I am a developer, I'll say 2 hours. But in 2 hours, I really don't deliver that, because in 2 hours, I'm probably checking my Facebook, I'll probably checking my Twitter, LinkedIn, or someone just called me for any help. And after 2 hours, if my manager comes and he'll say, is that done? I would say, oh, no. So that's where the problem comes in. You really don't deliver anything when you are saying, oh, this is the hard time I have. For the session, I would say, for this session, we have 60 minutes, but can we finish this session in 60 minutes? No, it can be in 30 minutes, it can be in 45 minutes, it can be in 15 minutes. So we really can't actually say how much time particular functionality will take to build and deliver if we are saying in hours. So what magic story point does to us? So story point basically a number that actually tells that how hard the story is, how hard the functionality is based on the complexity, based on the unknowns, and how much effort it's gonna take to build specific functionality. So this is the story point technique that we guys use. So it's, I don't have, okay. Let me use this. Okay, let me use this one. So these are two objects. Which one you think is smaller and which one you think is bigger? Right? So this is what we do in story point technique. So we actually define all the stories based on the size. So we first say the smallest size story, and in compared to smaller, we actually align to the larger part. So extra small, small, medium, large, extra large, and double XL. You can actually think about the t-shirt size as well. And what are these numbers? These numbers are actually a magic number, which we say a Fibonacci series, which has been used throughout the world in manufacturing industry for the estimation, car industries, and IT industry as well, specific to agile. So over here, when the exercise actually start, we have certain team members. So not a whole team, but usually the team which required to build the website, a dev will be there, or maybe a themer, and a tech architect, right? So these people, and one product manager who actually help all the business head who actually have all the information from the client or a specific feature. So as a team, we define and we place all these story based on the sizes. And based on the sizes, we actually move. So let's say a one dev comes in and move one story from medium to large because he thinks that this story is large. It's not to be in medium. And the other developer actually moves the story from large to medium. So when certain story gets moved to another size, we use a marker and put a dot on that story so that we can actually track, because there is some confusion in that story that we identified. At the end of the exercise, we actually check out all the dot stories and we talk to our product owner, and product owner actually clarify, okay, this is what the assumption is, and this is what we have to do. If certain story is not clear, then product managers will say that, okay, these stories we will not estimate as of now. We'll go back to client and we'll put an assumption and take if any clarification is needed. And over here, the important point is we are actually calculating the velocity, right? So after all these story points, we jot down that how many story points will be needed to complete this specific early estimation feature. So let's say we have 500 story points in this exercise. So it will not take much time. It actually take us, so let's say we have 200 stories or 200 features. It hardly take 15 to 20 minutes to complete this exercise. And after that, we sum all the story points. So let's say we have 500 story points, And we divide that story point into a team, in sprints. So let's say in sprint, we have 1 week of sprint, and we divide that sprint and estimation based on the team members we have. So let's say a 50% dev or 100% dev, there's a tech lead, there's a scrum master, and there's a QA which is available. Based on the team and the sprint, we divide and come from the velocity. Thanks. So the quick question which usually engineering team asks, how do we actually come to know that specific feature will take certain time? Because in early estimation, we do not have lots of information and lots of complexity that we need to build. But as we actually grow and as we actually build things, we can actually identify based on these factors how much a specific feature will take time to get delivered. So first is risk. That's one of the points that when I mentioned that the moving of the story, we actually track. And it comes in the picture that, okay, this story has certain risk or certain things or information is not clear, assumption is not clear. So we get rectified from the client. Second factor is the complexity. So for example, which we took is the solar search. It can have a lot of complexity, but what exactly client needs? So based on the assumption that we will take, okay, solar server needs to be configured, and there will be a search result page, and there will be a facets, and there will be a certain search query which will pull out the result, maybe a document search and all those things. So we take all those assumptions in the early estimate. Third factor is the effort, how much effort it will require. Not in hours that I'm going to finish this in 2 hours. It will never work. So for efforts, we actually took how much effort is going to be go for dev team to build this feature. Technology. Technology is also a great factor while we are estimating. In our case, Drupal is one. But let's say if there is a payment gateway and we are integrating payment gateway, do we have any module for that? Do we have to write a custom code for payment integration, or any other technology integration is required? I'm sorry, do you have a question?
I was just curious how you quantify effort.
Okay, all right. The last factor which we think about is the skills. So there are a lot of headless Drupal or there's a JavaScript framework, which I actually see is every week I see a new JavaScript framework, React.js and Angular.js and all those things. And the concept actually gets evolved as we are going ahead with the digital experience, customer experience. And over there, we actually have to also improve our skill set. So do we have a JS person in our company? Do we have a Drupal expert in our company? So those kind of skills, actually, we have to think while we are estimating. Because you're not going to let us say that, oh, I don't have a skill set for that. It will be a lot of miscommunication with the client, a lot of back and forth while the development is going on. So at that time only, we used to take care of the skill set as well. So yeah, so after completing this exercise, what worked for us, we are not estimating any feature based on ours. Everything is on size base. So we are actually saying that we are not saying that how much time a particular object or a particular object will take time to get delivered. We are saying, okay, this many effort will get put in building this particular functionality. Second, a fear of commitment. So usually in the engineering team, there is a fear of commitment that, should I say 2 hours? Should I say 6 hours to build this functionality? What time I exactly should put? Because if it will not take that time, my manager SM will definitely get whole manac. So at that point, the fear is gone. And it's human, actually. We say, okay, I'll be 10 minutes late, but it will maybe take 30 minutes, right? But if I'll just say, okay, I'll be in a couple of hours, right? So I'm not saying in specific time. I'm just saying I'll be in a couple of hours with you. So at that time, the fear factor is removed. We are just sizing these stories. We are not putting any hours into that. Focus client conversion in right direction. this is the main important factor, which I think when we are dealing with our clients, or a sales team or business team actually deals with our client. So there's one direction where we are thinking. Instead of saying we will deliver this functionality in these hours, instead of saying this is what we have to build and this is what effort it's going to be in your product or project which you want. So the focus conversation actually gets started at that point. So relative estimation, so it's actually research has been done, and it says that humans really are good with relative estimation as compared to absolute estimation. So when we are giving any relative estimation to particular thing in our in our daily life as well, if we are using a relative estimation, we usually go as close as to what we have to do. And yeah, the story estimation, the story point estimation is typically really very fast. This is the research which happened, and it says that if you are building using a traditional project management methodology, then you will actually be able to go a 50% close to your estimation. But if you are building on an agile methodology and using inner story points, then you can actually go to the 80% close to the estimation. And this is how it looks on field. So you can use your whiteboard, or you can use your tables, and this is how the exercise goes. Yeah, got it.
So, you know, and usually because it's an expensive exercise, right, where you're getting your guests in, you're getting your architects in, you want to make sure that, you know, it's not going to take a lot of time. You know, we typically do about 30 to 40, you know, quotes a month, or proposals a month. And, you know, I personally do it about 15. So, you know, we make sure that, you know, and we have limited time. So, you know, we make sure that it's all this usually gets in 5 to 10 hours, right? Which includes the client calls, which includes all the probing questions and everything to the level of the estimation, right? What essentially all goes into it, right? So, you know, we have been training our salespeople in, you know, a bit go in the calls along with the product owners and go and ask all these probing questions to find out the high level requirements, the ethics, you know, if you will, which essentially, you know, helps the devs to come in and understand what is, from a holistic level, the whole requirements look like, right? And then they go on and do the story point estimation on these large ethics. And, you know, this usually, you know, 1 hour calls, 2 hour calls, it's usually done over 4 or 5 calls with clients, right? And we just take notes over an Excel sheet, right? Which then gets detailed by the product owners. So the guys who are coming on the calls and the product owners are responsible asking these questions and putting them in the sheet, which is then can be used by the devs to go on and build their estimates, which usually take about 2 to 4 hours in total, you know, which is spread across a few days, right, you know, in different calls. Then you go into sizing the functionality, sizing the whole process that we talked about, which usually takes about 40 to 50 minutes. We have trained internally our devs, our people a lot, which, you know, doesn't really, so they come in, they know what they do, they know how the things need to be moved, and they have gone, and it usually takes 40 to 50 minutes to get all the sizing in place. Then we go back, you know, we review this with the sales team, and very good thing that has been happening very recently is that now, because, you know, this whole process is getting tied up and all the dots are connected, sales people are much more empowered to go to the clients and actually talk about, you know, what are the different unknowns that they have, and actually present a much detailed sheet which says, you know, apart from basic quotes, which is hours and these numbers, right? And say that this is the unknowns that we have. This is what we know. This is the complexity portion. This is the non-complex portion, right? And there is a very good base for the discussion. And we are able to rule out a lot of competitors because of the detail that we go on. And, you know, the mind that it doesn't take more than a day, you know, in totality.
Sessions are recorded. I want to close to the microphone.
Oh, okay.
I'm not used to that. Okay, my mistake. So yeah, so you go on to back to the sales team, right? And you give them, essentially empower them with the whole detailed understanding of why a number came in, if it came in, right? And then when everything is in place, everything is understood, the whole base, you go on and make sure that you find the velocity of the team. I'll talk about how do we do that, because the people who are going to estimate will not be the people who are going to deliver, right? Because it is estimations of early estimations, right? So how do you find the velocity in that case? And find out how many sprints, are going to take, to deliver that stuff. And it's usually a 15-20 minute exercise very quickly. And then very important part, that we go back and present this whole sheet transparently back to the client, right, along with the focus factor, and tell them, this is what we have done. This is what we have, understood from a requirement. This is what we have, understood from a detailing point of view. And this is how, we have estimated the whole effort. What do you see? Do you see any gaps? Do you see any thing that we have missed? What are your thoughts and everything? Now that engages clients on a very different level altogether. And because one of the things that we came up internally, right? So because we don't have the same teams delivering and estimating, we have segregated our developers in different, works in the appraisals and their salaries as well, in different segments. They have L2 developer, you have a L2 L1 developer, you have a senior L1, senior L2, teamer L1, teamer L2. And we have put in standards, and we said that if a senior developer is delivering X points, and this is on the basis of the data that we have, then a developer would be probably able to do 70% of that. A themer, usually, because theming is much more, you get a lot of changes coming in, a lot of feedbacks coming in, we put in a senior themer to 75% of the capacity, right, from a story points, and a junior themer or a mid-level themer to a 50% capacity to be able to deliver something. Does that make sense? Because it's a little complex to understand, right? But this has worked very nicely for us, right? It's a formula that we have used internally.
Can I ask how often you compare that against your data, this formulas? You compare it after every large project or quarterly, or is it once you don't do it?
Yeah. Well, we have been doing it probably quarterly now, right? Yeah, and it's everyone is involved into it. So there are we have three offices in India, development centers, and every BU head is really involved into this, and it goes into, their appraisals, discussions, and everything, which happens, again, every quarter at Sijan, right? So, all this data actually binds together, every quarter.
How is your accuracy level?
Right now, it's actually pretty good. That's what I'm saying. It's really working for us, right? And, it really, and this is, again, it's very transparent to the client as well, right? The client knows that these are the people, with this seniority, these are the different rates for these different people, and this is what they're going to deliver, right? And it again depends on, how complex or how easy the project is going to be, right? And, because of this different capacity and different velocity, we actually are able to give them a range as well, right? So if you want a leaner team, essentially does development in a longer time, right? You have a different velocity altogether. If you're going, yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. So this, I've been doing Agile for quite a while. This is the first time I've ever seen that a factor times the points based on the level of the developer. That is really interesting. I've never seen that. But I want to ask about why do you do the total? Maybe you're going to get to that. Why do you have that factor?
Yeah, this is because of this one.
Okay.
Because of this. Because, you go in and you always want to make sure that you don't go with an absolute number. You want to go with the range. Right? You want to go with the range, and you want to say that this to this is what we think, right? And then go into discovery and do a better estimation in place, right? No, so you're paying 100% for everyone.
Okay.
Yeah, you're paying 100% for everyone. You're not paying any. So no one is. So if you look at the sheet, it's actually pretty tiny. I never realized that it would be that tiny. But if you look at it from the depth of you know, if I put in all senior developers, then you know, even then it's not going to work, right? Because you have to pace development in a certain way, right? So you have to have a mix in place, right? And if there is a senior developer, that's the different cost altogether, right? And if you have a junior developer, there's a different cost altogether. So, and it, the whole metrics come out very nicely and depending on the complexity of the project, right? For example, this one, if you can see, that's a pretty large team, pretty stiff team, right? And because it was a marketplace, right? And which is supposed to be live in 4 months, right? So you need to have a stiff team with 100% capacity in place. But if you don't have that scenario, right, then you probably a themer in a 50% capacity would do, right? Which is, you know, which is not probably doing X points like a senior person, right, in the place. And, you know, again, it all depends on, you know, how easy the client is, you know, with all these conversations coming in. And when do you bring all these conversations, right? You know, and this is also, I don't know if I'm able to capture everything here, you know, in this one presentation, but I think we have learned that slowly and slowly over the time on when do we bring these conversations in, right? Should we bring it early? Should we bring in, you know, later in the stage? And, you know, it largely, so we, you know, at Srijan stick with long accounts, right? The strategy is always to go with long accounts, not with projects. We have really stopped looking for projects for a long time now. And, you know, wherever we have found the right people, you know, who have been in the industry, who've seen projects failing, they appreciate all this by a huge margin, right? They appreciate it. They appreciate the transparency. They appreciate we all telling them, you know, the real truth, right? And saying that, you know, this is going to be the focus factor. You cannot have, you know, everyone delivering at 100% capacity, you know, at always, right? And this is the truth. So I think they appreciate it, and we've been able to find all these people.
When you are responding, or do you just choose not to respond to estimates that they're asking for a total hours breakdown, or not even a breakdown, but a total hours, do you just kind of extrapolate an average rate and say, yeah, this is our range, and that's going to be about 4,000 hours?
No, we don't do ours. We don't do ours. We don't do ours. And, you know, we don't try and say no that we're not doing ours. We try and make them understand that what we are trying to do, right? And we go on and keep on talking about story point, you know, after the other. And it slowly start making sense to them. And if they're not engaging, then we just move on. You know, it just doesn't make sense. Yeah, so the pricing is now, with all this thing, right, when you have done this estimations and everything, story points is in place, right, and you have found the velocity there, you know, of the team, now then you know that what is the total number of story points and what your team can deliver in a sprint, right? With that, you find how many sprints are you going to do, right? So you can see that sprint 1, sprint 2, sprint 3, sprint 4, 6, 7, right, 8. So you say that you're going to take 8 sprints, one developer costs this much, this is a burn down for a particular sprint, and this is the total cost, right? And again, we try and go with the range, as I mentioned earlier, right, which, you know, still leaves that, you know, ambiguity in place for the discovery to kick in. No, so we work with dedicated teams. The only people that are not dedicated sometimes, and usually we have even stopped doing that for some time now, is themers. We used to put 50% themers earlier, but you know now we don't see it working. You know, but you know, yeah, it's usually all dedicated teams. So one project end, and then they move on to the next one, all dedicated. If luxury is the right word, right? I think when we have looked at the whole ROI, right, and that's one of the responsibility of the salespeople to show the whole ROI and say that you're putting 50%, 60%, you know, and looking at the, you know, if see again, you know, we're looking at people who are experienced in delivering you know, products from the client side, right, who have some, you know, history of delivering products, right? And they know that a person not dedicated doesn't give a good product out, doesn't give the quality out, right? And yeah, so, you know, it again depends a lot in contracting, right? And we in ideal scenario, we would always want to be a time and material, but it doesn't happen. So we sometimes go for fixed cost, we sometimes go for time and material. If there is, and you know, we have been doing all this thing just to make sure that it doesn't go overshoot, right? And we've been putting all these efforts. So, for example, in this particular case with the marketplace, we exceeded by one sprint. One sprint was exceeded, but it was pretty large. So we took that one sprint, you know, hurt for us. So we didn't bill that to the client. But again, you know, it depends. So usually, when the clients get a little older with us, they get comfortable and they have a lot of trust. They don't mind being on time and material. But usually, to start off with, we usually start with fixed price projects actually. Yeah, yeah, right. Again, yeah, this is a contracting portion, yeah.
When you're coming up with solutions to the story points, and you're doing that based on, in a sense, your past experience and your marketing expertise, is there any way to get value added for that so they don't just think of you as a dead shot because you are coming up with complicated solutions that perhaps a more of a marketing team would actually be telling you what to do?
Yeah. Actually, pretty good point, right? And I think that's clearly a struggle for us, right? To be honest, we have been pretty focused on engineering, totally the engineering capability till date. So we don't do designs, we don't do marketing, any marketing things, right? We don't do anything that like that. All this done with partners, right? And we actually bring our engineering capabilities till date, right? I think, but. Yeah, that's a place where we are trying to go with solutions, you know, as per se, and say that, you know, if you're looking at these solutions, if there's a total unknown area, right, completely, you know, and starting with a pain problem, we are trying to do with the product owners in place, which are, you know, kind of building them as industry experts internally. But I would not say that we are still there. We are still, you know, trying to do. Probably.
Is there something value added that you can somehow package in or say, look, it's this price because we have this other thing that we're offering? You know,
yeah, yeah. Yeah, probably. Yeah, that's a good thought, actually. That's a good thought. Yeah. Thanks for that. Sure. So, coming back, so we go and share the range, right? And we've been trying to be accurate in the past. The more you go back to the developers, you know, the more estimates seem to be getting decreased, right? And the more you put in more efforts, the more things get creeped in, right? So it's better to be that ambiguous in the start internally, and this is internal thing that we have understood, and go with trying to sell the whole process of this whole estimation and the delivery process to them. So we, you know, rather than trying to focus the whole conversation around what is the, you know, effort and, you know, what we have understood from the functionality, we bring in the whole expertise of the delivery, you know, doing, right? How we are going to deliver, how we have spent so much time in, and we talk about how we have done it in the past, you know, with the clients. And, you know, we break the projects in smaller releases, right? And if you look at the last line, it says, contract for small releases, budget for the larger, right? So, you know, if we go on and we do this whole exercise, we usually, you know, when we are working with large projects, you know, it goes up to 6 months, 7 months kind of engagements. And, you know, signing that big engagement is usually a little difficult for a lot of clients, right? And we try and focus then, okay, don't do that. Don't go with a larger contract with us. Go with a smaller contract. Go with a four sprint contract. You know, and we have been, you know, pretty good in terms of delivering stories, so sprints after sprints, because of the whole dedicated team effort and the processes we have put in. And you know, once we have shown the value, you know, it really helps. And so internally, from a sales angle, we also shift the conversation from other salespeople and say, while other sales guys are looking for the longer contract, we are looking for a shorter contract with clients. Yeah, we talk about number of sprints and delivering value, you know, every sprint. And what it doesn't also capture that we put in goals for each sprint, right? And it's pretty easy. You know, we do that. We have been doing that now with the whole that estimation technique. And we say that, you know, very holistically, we're going to do that in the first sprint, content types in the first sprint, taxonomy in the first sprint, second sprint, we'll do this pages, this sections, third sprint, this pages, migration will go on, you know, all the sprints, and, you know, we put in all these goals together, right? Especially for the people who really want a Gantt chart, you know, to be pitched from us, right? And it really has been also helping, which doesn't capture here. You know, just very quickly, I wanted to capture on, we've been pretty lean in the sales team. You know, we have a US sales rep, we have an India sales rep, we have Asia sales rep, and then we have the solutions team who comes in and helps in. And everything is actually overseen by the CEO of the company. Yeah, and again, this is, I've talked about that, the expected velocity, right? So we talked about the velocity and say that while, and you know, this is a difficult conversation always, right? While we have done all this maths there, still there is a lot of ambiguity that's there left, right? And you know, you might not get all the velocity in the first sprint. So, and you will gradually going to increase the velocity as you go in the project, right? And we try and bring that conversation in the sales as well. Right, with the clients, again, transparent. And yeah, you know, we're trying to be more transparent with what we have been doing in from a delivery angle and showing to the clients. And some things working, some things are not working, but yeah, we are getting there. And you know, we plan the UAT time as well. It is actually built in the contracts. This is again a learning that we had, that we specify time of the client and say that you can see the sprint one, and after the sprint one, you can see that you have a UAT time defined for the client, right? So if the client doesn't complete the UAT by that time after that sprint and doesn't sign off and tell them what is being delivered, what is approved, what is not approved, right, then there is a contingency in the contract, right? And make sure that, you know, that's going to cost them extra, right? So that's one of the things that we force from a contracting angle as well, the UAT time that they have to put in. After the sprint, the first sprint, yeah. So, is that the question?
No, in column M and the N, when there's user acceptance testing, is that the first time?
No. Oh, sorry. So that's one of the more, that's the extra sprint that we put in after the whole development. But the client actually sees the project product after every sprint. So this 2 to 5 November, you can see, right, just after the first sprint, essentially the first UAT time. And then we bring in one more UAT sprint at the end to iron out everything and go live before a production deployment, right? But the UAT happens after every sprint, and the acceptance also happens after every sprint from a story points. And internally, we have a mandate that every team has to deliver 90% of the stories after every sprint, and that affects their appraisals, their salaries, their bonuses, everything. Get accepted by the client. Yeah, get accepted by the client. If it doesn't, then it, you know, impacts the entire team's bonuses and salaries. Yeah. Also, what worked that, you know, and usually this comes in, you know, once we have done this estimations and the estimations are out, and I'm actually flying to Boston this Friday for a similar workshop, right? And you know, when we have some understanding of the cost out there, some agreement of the process out there, right? We go on and start investing on these brainstorming workshops, right? And help them get more structured, you know, in the unknowns, bring in the unknowns, right? And that is where we help them bring the cost back also. A lot of time, and because, you know, all the transparency kicking in, right? We can have the conversation like, okay, you don't have, you know, $200,000, you know, budget. You have 150 or you have 100. Now what I think we think that you should be getting delivered in 100,000. And we come in and, you know, try and do that. And now because we have done all this groundwork, and because that is transparent to the client, we can have all this conversation. Okay, you don't have the budgets, but let us work under your budgets, and let us tell you what is important in terms of your MVP or what you should not looking at deliver at all, which might not be useful at all for your company or for your business completely. Yeah, so we get into all these brainstorming workshops and help them understand that requirements. And yeah, you know, every you know, this is also, I've just noted down a few things that are really working for us. You know, you know, there are different stakeholders with enterprises, right? And we are sending the status emails every 2 weeks to all the stakeholders involved, not the product owner. Usually what happens that product owner is usually not the final decision maker from the client's end, right? So we've been sending all the status emails to everyone and telling them what is being delivered every 2 weeks and what is the burn, what are the risks, you know, what are the, you know, complexities coming in, what are the ambiguities still there, so that, and we put in a color marking as well, right, which helps all these business stakeholders jumping in and saying that, oh, there is a red mark. Let me get, you know, in and try and solve whatever is the roadblock for the development team. And we force the discovery, you know, and show the need that, you know, you have to get into a discovery. You know, we have done a lot of things, but unless and until we do a discovery, don't really contract us for the entire thing. Just contract us for a discovery. If you don't like us, you can take the discovery and go to a different client altogether, right? That also helps, been helping a lot. And you know, because we have done all this groundwork, discovery, and we have been able to sell discovery because of all that. Because then you have a clear unknowns there, and we have been able to say that this is because you need the discovery, because of all these unknowns that are in the picture, because of these complexities in the picture. And then, you know, this is another trick that I've seen, you know, which helps, that you insist on getting the designs out before you sign the final contract, right? And this is all when it's done, and the client is really desperate to sign the contract. We hold the contract till the designs are not out there, right? Just to make sure that there is not ambiguity, right? We have, you know, it's not always, right? It depends on, you know, how hard they are in, you know, with us. But yeah, insisting on designs coming out, really helping out also. From a delivery point of view. Last slide, essentially. Yeah, last slide, Lucas. Yeah, last slide. So be transparent on estimation and all multipliers. I know I've been saying again and again. And help sales team with the purchasing process. You know, I know sales people are being hated globally. I'm one of the sales guys. But I think a lot of empathy, if given in, you know, can help them really succeed in a very well way. And, you know, free audits followed with a paid audit exercise, POCs, you know, doing that all investment when you have all this thing done and when you're going for the brainstorming exercises also, you know, helps a lot in selling. That would be it. Questions? Yep.
So you're not estimating hardware, because most solutions now, or a lot of them, have a hardware component. I don't see you could do that in a day.
No. Hardware as in what? Security devices?
The infrastructure. I need this million site, you know, this big site, and now I need an AWS.
Yeah. So we work extensively with Platform, Acquia. We've been working at Acquia for actually a very long time. The sizing and everything, we bring them in. We don't do it ourselves, right? And Pantheon, Platform.sh, we actually work with all of them. Yeah. Okay. And we have a Indian partner as well who does the AWS sizing and the AWS implementation. So if they don't want to go any of them, and they're looking at cheap infrastructure, we go to this particular partner and let them do the sizing piece. As I mentioned, we are very focused on Drupal. We are just focused on Drupal, all 180 people, all on Drupal and Angular, right? So very focused on one piece, no designs, no infrastructure, no marketing bit, nothing. We're just going to focus on one thing. Okay, so you know, that essentially is a relative estimation, right? So relative, so you put looking at, let's say, you know, you say that sign in, you're going into and, you know, just signing into a firm, right? That's probably a one story point. You're looking at, you know, then a particular different story which says you create a few blocks, right? That is a, you know, probably three story points. That's much larger than the simple sign in, right? So it's again a relative estimate, basis of what the understanding is from a complexity point of view. Yeah. So again, I think we've been working on that, right? We've been working on that. We've been trying to templatize that. Yes. You know, from a training point of view, we have been haven't really done that. You know, it's usually a lot of responsibility that lies with me, the product owners, to really define these epics. Right, you know, sales teams are responsible, or sales people are responsible to define the starting bit of, you know, doing the demos, doing the, you know, initial understanding. But then this product owner comes in and does all this, you know, epics defined. Right, yeah. Yeah. Sorry, come again. Yeah, story points. Right now, it's velocity of sprint for 2 weeks.
For
a sprint, correct. So the velocity is for a sprint.
And velocity you can also define. Maybe your sprint is up 1 week, so 1 week velocity.
Yeah. Yeah, one sprint. So it depends, right? How do you want to do it? So we are doing in a sprint. You want to do in a day, you can do that. It's not going to really change a lot. Yeah. No, it's then, you know, we have a burst team capacity defined. So we have a extended team defined, and say that if you don't go in, we're going to do an extension of the team by a sprint, right? And that's going to cost you this much. That's what it is. Fantastic.
Thank you.
I don't know if we ever got a...